Amigas y amigos, ladies and gentlemen, my name is Ignacio Peiró, and it is my pleasure to welcome you on behalf of Instituto Cervantes London to what I think is going to be a very inspiring evening, the launch of an epic novel of revenge and retribution, Guillermo Arriaga's The Untamable, which has just been published a few days ago. I would like to thank you all for being with us today, and of course, a big gracias goes as well to our partners in crime this evening, Millie Reid and our friends from Kirkus Books, Ana Elena González Treviño from the Center for Mexican Studies, a joint initiative of UNAM and King's College London. I would also like to thank Dr. Olivia Vázquez Medina, who is a fellow at Wadham College in Oxford, and who, as an expert in Latin American fiction, will be hosting the talk today. It really is a privilege to have you with us, Olivia. The Untamable is already earning a wide acclaim all over the UK, and this should come as no surprise, considering Arriaga's trajectory, which has been defined by success, whether we're talking about his work as an author, director, or screenwriter. Having the man himself with us today, I am not going to delve deep into his new book, but I can tell you that those who know him from Babel, Amores Perros, or The Guillotine Squad will be thrilled by it. Well, this is going to be all from me, and Ana Elena González from the Mexican University UNAM will take the floor now. And just let me add a small reminder of how this is going to work. While Olivia and Guillermo are talking, feel free to ask any question you have in the chat, write it down in the chat, and Olivia will read your questions to Guillermo at the end of the talk. Muchas gracias and enjoy your evening. Ana Elena.
Hello, welcome everybody. It is a great pleasure for me to be here with you, welcoming Guillermo Arriaga. And as the director of the National University of Mexico's office in the UK at King's College London, I am very, very pleased to be in this collaboration with the Instituto Cervantes. And I really look forward to hearing the presentation. And we are very keen in promoting Mexican writers, bright Mexican writers like Guillermo Arriaga, and welcome you all. I'm sure we'll have a great evening. Thank you.
Hola, Guillermo.
Hello.
Hello. Hi to everybody. It's nice to meet you finally. I'm so glad that we'll be able to have this chat this evening. I think you were going to get us started by reading a little bit from your novel. Is that what you're going to do first?
No, I don't have plan to read something about my novel. I don't have it here with me.
You don't have it? Okay, that's fine. Then I will, I thought you might want to, but that's okay. We can get straight into the conversation. And maybe it would be good to just get us started by just telling everybody what the novel is about. I had just planned to maybe just summarize a few words about the main storyline of the novel. So as some of you will know, The Untamable is set in the late 1960s and it follows two main storylines that eventually become connected, as we might have come to expect from Guillermo's previous work. So one of these stories is set in Mexico City and the other one is set in Canada's far north in the tundra. So in Mexico City, a young man, Juan Guillermo, has pledged revenge after his brother Carlos has been killed by Catholic fanatics colluded with a corrupt police commander. And Juan Guillermo's parents also die shortly after as a result of their grief. In the other story, in the parallel story, a young Inuit hunter tracks a wolf through the wilderness while following an ancestral call conveyed by his grandfather. So that's kind of the starting premise for the whole thriller that ensues. And I'm not going to give anything more away at this point, but obviously you might want to give something more away later, or I'm sure other details might emerge later on. I guess I wanted to start by asking you about the idea for this novel, kind of the history of this novel. How did you come up with the idea? How did the process evolve? And what was the process of writing it like?
Hello?
Hi, you're breaking up a bit, Guillermo.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you now.
Okay, perfect. I'm sorry. First of all, thanks, Olivia, for this conversation. Thanks for all the organizations, the Institute Cervantes in London, of course, my publishing house, UNAM at the UK, Ignacio, thank you very much. Mili, thank you very much. And everyone that is now connected, I'm very honored to have you listening me to talk about my novel. You know, I grew up in a neighborhood in the south part of Mexico City. It's called Unidad Modelo. Can you hear me?
Yes, I think.
Can you hear me?
Yes, I cannot see you though. I don't know if, I can see you now, yes. So you were just saying you grew up in Unidad Modelo.
Yeah, I grew up in Unidad Modelo, which is this neighborhood. And I think that a lot of interesting things happen in that neighborhood. Amores Perros, for example, comes from that neighborhood. Let me try something else. I'm going to see if with my data I can have better reception. Hold on one sec, please.
Yes, sure.
Hello? I'm gonna change the Wi-Fi. Hold on a second.
We'll wait here.
Hello, can you hear me now well?
Yes, I think that's better,
yeah. I'm right now in a little town in the north of Mexico. So you got me traveling, so I'm sorry. Okay.
It's wonderful that we can do this while you're traveling. It's great we can do it.
Yeah, I'm traveling. I'm basically like 30 miles from the border with Texas now. Very close to the Rio Grande, to the Rio Bravo. So I grew up in this neighborhood and I think it was an interesting place to grow. And a lot of things were happening on that place. There were some things going on in the late of the 60s. And I'm gonna give a historic context of what was happening in Mexico at that time. In the 68, like many countries in the world, like France or like the United States, there were some movements by the students that have some leftist tone or inclination. And the government in Mexico, there were gonna be the Olympic Games, and there were these manifestations, all these movement around. They decided to repress fiercely the movement with a lot of people killed. The army went into control these. There were snipers dressed as civil. And so it was a tough moment. And in my neighborhood, for example, I was 10 years old when that happened. If you were playing in the streets, the police will go in these trucks, they will go down, chase you, hit you with, if you were a little bit older, they would take you to the police station. So in Mexico, there has never been an ultra-right wing political movement, except for these years, those years, sorry. in order to counter attack the leftist young students, they allow Catholic fundamentalist groups to come to the surface. So this is a little bit of the historic context of the novel. And I think this was interesting to tell from a point of view, from really it was a hood, it was my neighborhood. It's not that I grew up just in the city. It's like I knew basically the name of everyone. We spent all the time in the streets. There were things going on in the streets when I was a kid. So I thought that it was gonna be interesting to tell those stories since I was like 14.
Wow. And when you know, when one reads the novel, you really get that sense of being there, of, you know, the neighborhood, the sense of place that the reader gets from the novel is very intense. I mean, I think you are one of the you know, great contemporary writers of Mexico City. You write so much about Mexico City, but not as if it was one monolithic place. We really get a sense of the different neighborhoods, as you say, about the area. So a lot of questions kind of emerge from this. One has to do with how do you convey that sense of historical moment and also setting in a novel? And how would that be different, for example, in a screenplay?
Well, first of all, when I begin writing the story, I have no idea where it's heading. I just have slight concepts or slight storylines that will guide me, but basically I have no idea what's going on, what is going to happen, who the characters are going to be, and of course I have no idea how it's going to end. So I write as things are coming, and whatever happens in my daily life goes into the novel. It's writing outside, inside the novel. If there's an accident, okay, so hear me, okay? I'm okay?
Yes, you're breaking up a bit, but you're back now.
Okay, sorry. So I began discovering the novel while I am writing it. And it's not that I have it clear, like many of my, that they have a plan, a map of how they're gonna write. I just go and what is coming. For example, there's a storyline that happens in Canada.
Mm-hmm.
I have no idea that story was going to come. The book has several legends and historical facts that are like the prologue of every chapter.
Yes.
For example, I talk about a very famous Scottish doctor in the 18th century called John Hunter. And as a prologue of what the kid wants to do, he wants to steal a fetus, human fetus he has in the school, and he wants to steal it. So John Hunter is a prologue of what John Hunter was doing, that he has an amazing collection that people can still see in London of skeletons and heads and organs and everything. So this guy wants to steal the fetus. An 8-month fetus that it's displayed in the laboratory in his school, in his, I don't know, it's elementary school, I think, when you're like 12, 13. Yes.
Secondary.
Okay. And what makes a difference between a novel and a screenplay is the point of view.
Mm-hmm.
A novel, it's always narrated in first person, even though you don't narrate it in first person. What I mean is the moment you go inside the mind of the character, that's a first person. And cinema is always a third person. You have always to watch, always to have a distance. So that's what makes a difference. And in this novel, The Untamable, is basically the point of view of the characters all the time is narrated in first person. And even though the other part is narrated in the third person, it always has the point of view or what's going on inside the minds and the emotions of the characters.
Yes, I was going to ask you precisely about the emotions, because this is, I mean, this is a very emotional book. It's, I think to a great extent, it is a book about pain, you know, in many ways about emotional pain, physical pain, and the two become kind of interconnected as well. And this is very much conveyed even through the writing itself. The writing is very intense, and there are moments when one is reading that even the typography of the sentences and the letters and so on is almost like it's coming apart because of the sheer pain that one of the characters or the protagonist is experiencing. And I suppose that is something that happens on the written page that would be completely different on a screenplay. But I wanted to ask you about that, how do you write something like that? Because it is really so intense that it must have been quite an intense process of writing it.
Well, I'm going to just tell a little bit about the story. So
yes, please.
About it. It's a 14-year-old kid whose brother is murdered. His there's only two brothers. His older brother is six and a half years older than him. And his murder, we slowly began to know how he's murdered. And because of the pain that the parents are, it's too overwhelming to them and to the grandmother, they die also. And the dog dies, and the parakeets die, everything dies around him when he is the age of 17. And he has to answer two questions. Should I revenge?
Yeah.
Will I have a vengeance? Or shall I not? And then how I will survive, I'm only on my own. And that what is the story basically it's about, is how this kid is going.
We've lost you
the again. The story of the hunter. I'm breaking.
Yes, you are a bit. I think you're back now.
I'm back.
Yes, you're back. Sorry, you got interrupted a bit. You did break a bit.
Let me see if my data works better. Hold on. Hello?
Hi.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, you're back.
Now I have the data on my phone. I hope this will work better. So I was telling you that there's the story of this kid who wants to see how is he gonna survive and if he's gonna take revenge or not. And on the other side, there's a story of a Inuit hunter in the Yukon in Canada, who in the middle of the winter is chasing a wolf to hunt the wolf. And he begins to have a relationship with this specific wolf because his grandfather says, of all the animals you're gonna hunt, one is gonna exchange a glance with you, and that one, that is you. So you have to hunt in this life because you know you're gonna be condemned to hunt the rest of your life. So this Inuit hunter goes and tries to hunt the wolf. Slowly, both storylines began to merge. So that's something I just want to tell the audience that has no idea what this book is about. And writing about pain, you know something? You have to use life experience, not only mine, but people I have known, people that surround me. And It's not that it's a painful process for me because I'm really enjoying writing.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that I cry or I am tortured by it. I am really enjoying it. Mm. I enjoy very much writing. It doesn't cause me the pain that maybe it causes the readers because I know it's fiction. And I know I'm putting imagination and a lot of things. I'm not an orphan. Well, I'm now an orphan. I have just lost my mother due to COVID and my dad 2 years ago. But the kid is an orphan, but
you
know, you have to imagine how being an orphan means.
Yes, I mean, you insert some autobiographical details in the novel, but I mean, I don't want to ask you, is this an autobiographical novel? Because I don't think that is very productive. But I suppose I could ask, what is the intention or what is the purpose of, you know, having a character that is called Juan Guillermo, who grows up on Unidad Modelo, where we know you grew up. I mean, even the address, the street where these kids live, Retorno 201, is the title of your first, your short story collection, and is this part of Mexico City. So what is kind of, what are you getting at with this autobiographical details in the novel?
It's not that it's autobiographical. I'm just using life experiences.
Yeah. No?
I say this is based on facts, in real facts that never happened.
Very good.
Okay.
I wanted to ask you about the wolf. I mean, I have the copy of the novel here, and what I noticed about this is the English edition. This is the Untamable, and this is El Salvaje in Spanish. And in both cases, we have kind of the wolf and a human shade, or a human form kind of coming together. And I mean, we know animals are so important in your work from Amores Perros, and we see it here, obviously. So who is the untamable, I suppose, is a question that remains in the novel, because animals are connected to so many things in the novel, to a sort of instinct and force and resilience and survival. But why are animals such an important thing in your writing?
Animals have been very important for me in life. I used to have a lot of animals when I was a kid. I am a hunter, so I am vinculated with animals. I'm related to animals all the time. And I know that hunting causes some creep in some people, but it depends on how you hunt and the respect you have for the animals you hunt. And basically, I hunt, for example, with bow and arrow, which is extremely difficult. And you have feel you belong to nature in order to hunt with bow and arrow, because you have to blend in nature. You have to understand nature. You have to understand the animals. And then I have a dog called Coffee, which was the inspiration for Amores Perros, which was ferocious, a ferocious dog. So it's when you have a pet that questions you, that is extremely fierce. It's not the dog that it's all the time happy, that this dog was really ferocious. And to control him was like difficult. Mm-hmm. So since I was like 8 years old, I was growing up with this ferocious animal, very ferocious animal. I think that that's important also for this novel.
Yes, definitely. And we sort of partake in this process of taming the animal. And again, it's connected to pain in so many ways. It's kind of there at the heart of the novel. I wanted to go back to a couple of things you said earlier. One had to do with the situation in Mexico City or in Mexico and the history of the late 1960s. Obviously, you wrote this novel a few years ago now, but you were looking at Mexico's recent history. And throughout your work, again, you talk about, you know, corruption, abuse of power, violence, and so many other problems that are part of Mexico and continue to be part of Mexican life, I guess. But how was this process of maybe looking back to Mexico's recent history? Did you feel that, you know, writing about this time period in 2000, I don't know when you wrote the novel. I know El Salvaje was published, the Spanish was published in 2016, I believe. So did you have a sense that some things had got better by the time you were writing the novel, looking back at the 1960s? Or what was your kind of historical gaze on that period that you were writing about?
I think that the novel anticipates the problems that now Mexico has. And I think that every country has a breaking point. Germany has its breaking point, the Second World War, and the United States States has its breaking point with the slavery and the genocide. Every country has a breaking point. And Mexico now has a breaking point. Mm-hmm. And I think that this novel anticipates what was going to happen. Corruption and impunity are, I think, two of our greatest problems. And of course, the unjust distribution of the wealth. Mm-hmm. Those three problems has caused they broke what this concept of nation means. You know, the nation is an abstract concept, sorry. And so it was broken. It was broken since many years ago. And I think that it anticipates what's going on. And my new book, which is called Save the Fire, Salvar el Fuego, addresses all of these contemporary problems.
Yes, I look forward to finish. I have not finished Salvar el Fuego. Again, it's a long novel, like The Untamable.
I know, a little bit longer. But let me tell you something. In Unidad Modelo, it begins what it's called in Mexico, Narco Menudeo, which is the small, drug dealing, you know? Is the gangs controlling the drug dealing. Where I grew up, there was a lot of cocaine and marijuana and LSD and all mushrooms, everything that can get you high. And of course, alcohol. And police cannot get in some places of the neighborhood. It was so tough, they do not dare to go in. They know they were getting severe problems if they got in the hood. So those things began to happen in Mexico in the 60s, and I was watching them in real time. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yes, and again, these are situations that are very much at the core of the plot in the novel. They are also reflected there. I wanted to ask you about something you said earlier when you were talking about the storylines. A lot of your work, I think, deals with very bleak situations and characters in great conflicts, moral conflicts, questions about, you know, the choices that characters make and the consequences of those choices and the compromises that they need to make. But at the same time, so there is an issue of kind of moral responsibility and agency, I guess. But on the other hand, we get a feeling that characters are often, in a way, trapped in something bigger than them. That might be a corrupt society, or it might be relations of power, or maybe even an idea of fate. So I wanted to ask you a little bit about this conflict, and maybe I'm reading too much into it, but for me, there is this conflict between kind of the individual and the moral responsibility on the one hand, and on the other hand, something bigger. And is there a sense of entrapment for your characters? Is there a sense also, you know, fate as something that limits human agency or responsibility?
No, I think that it has nothing to do with fate. It has to do with Ortega y Gasset. You know, I am myself and my circumstances. Yo soy yo y mis circunstancias. So that's something that really impressed me, because many times you are you, but many times you are your circumstance. And I have always explored how much are we ourselves and how much we are circumstances. So I think that's the core of all of my work, and how circumstances do not become the greatest obstacle. Because in most of my work, characters overcome circumstances. So, but they are impacted by them. So it's this kind of tension.
Yes, you know? Yes, definitely.
Just let me say something, because I haven't said that the cover of the book is a great work by McElholz Press, which is releasing my and Frank Wine, who was a translator. I want to thank them both, McElholz Press and Frank Wine. He came to Mexico, Frank, to see me, and so he was generous, and we worked together the translation and very proud to have him on board.
That is great. I mean, I wanted to ask you about that, whether you participated in the translation, because I imagine there would have been sections or passages that would have been really hard to translate. I mean, I remember, for example, an example of albures, which is this, you know, Mexican double entendre that is very hard to translate. And that kind of thing, or, you know, the things that have to do with the barrio, with the neighborhood, a way of speaking, a way. So how much did you collaborate in the translation, and were there things that you thought were hard to translate?
Of course, I trust the translators. But there are some things that you need to be from Mexico to understand the context. So I always try to be there to help the translators, just to explain things that have these nuances of the language, all these cultural flavor that something even Mexicans do not understand. Mexicans who are not from the hood, they do not understand. So I need to explain some things.
Yes, I mean, there were also some, you refer in the book, some cultural codes and you know, ways in which characters from the neighborhood kind of realize who is from the neighborhood and who they are not. So I think there are kind of several layers to be able to understand what's happening. I had a couple of other questions, and then I'll start reading some of the questions in the chat. I think there were, I wanted to just ask you maybe as a last question, how do you combine the different sort of professions you have? Because obviously you are a novelist, you also write screenplays, you are a director, a producer. Then you say you're a hunter as well. I don't know if that's a profession or some sort of other definition, but how do these all different sides of you sort of interact or come together?
Well, basically, I can only do one thing at a time. So directing a movie or writing a novel demands not only time, but physical fitness.
Of course.
Directing a film is very physical, but also sitting for 12 hours every day, not moving. I gained a lot of weight with these two novels I've written. I gained like 30 pounds. It's kind of demanding, but I directed short pieces. I directed short films. I was hired to direct short films. I am producing films. I haven't stopped producing films. We even won the Golden Lion with a film I produced.
Yes,
the first film in Spanish that wins a Golden Lion in the Venice Film Festival, which for me it's a major achievement. So I produce that film. I'm producing in Brazil, I'm producing in Spain, I'm producing in the States, so in Mexico, of course. And so I try to go from one place to the other, but right now I am focused on writing novels. I already got pregnant from the new one. I wrote The Untamable, then after 1 month I finished it, I began writing Save the Fire.
Wow.
You Save the Fire. 1 month later, I was writing my new novel, gosh, which is going to surprise English readers, by the way.
Can you tell us a bit about that novel or
no,
not?
I can't. But it's going to surprise English readers because it has to do with English.
Okay.
So I try to do both things. Right now, I'm gonna produce the film of my son and my daughter, Santiago and Mariana. They co-direct. And I wrote a trilogy that was Upon Open Sky, Amores Perros, and 21 Grams. That was the original trilogy. And Upon Open Sky hasn't been filmed.
Right.
So I gave it to my kids. They're gonna direct that. I am going to direct that, and I'm going to direct Squadron Guillotina based on my first novel, Guillotine Squad.
Yes.
By the way, I am the house of a very good friend, which is a very prestigious actor here in Mexico, Jorge. I want you to introduce you to Jorge Jimenez, which this is his house. This is Jorge.
Hola, Jorge.
So
hello.
He's gonna be in my film. And he was in my last film that we presented in Venice. And if anyone meets a great, 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 great actor, this is the guy you have to call.
Oh, perfect. Mucho gusto.
Well, no, he has been in Netflix as a protagonist in a Netflix series. I've been working with him for long, and he's now in a lot of films. And he's gonna be, he was a protagonist of my last film as a director, so.
Excellent. I wanted to ask you also if Salvar el Fuego is being translated into English anytime soon.
No, we were in conversations. So that is even more difficult to translate,
yes,
because it has the slang all the way.
And it has different narrative voices as well. So, well, yeah, anyway.
It has different narrative voices. And one of the narrative voices is not even told in slang, it's called in Northern slang from mm-hmm. here, from where I am. Mm-hmm. And a very Chilango slang, which yes. is Mexico City hardest slang. So let's see what happens.
Great, Guillermo. I'm just going to... Somebody, Pilar Morales, is asking if the book is published in Spain, and it is. It's called El Salvaje, and I think it is published in Spain.
It's published through all of the Spanish-speaking countries. Alfaguara, it was very well sold in Spain and in Mexico, and there it is. You can find it in any bookstore.
Yes. Stephen Fahey is asking, how did you research the section set in Canada?
I do not do any kind of research. So I've been to Canada, and while I wrote that piece, I was hunting in New Zealand in the snow. So I guess the snow in New Zealand has to do a lot with the snow in Canada. So... No, I really don't do any kind of research. This book I'm writing is the only one I have done research in my life.
Oh, wow. But you cannot tell us what it is about.
I can't tell you what it's about.
Okay, we have to wait. Ada Say is asking who your favorite character in the book is.
It's difficult to have a favorite character because it's like asking which of my kids is the favorite. So I think that every character has something that it's interesting. A friend of mine, Sergio Avilés. Sergio Avilés is the character that brings the more light to it. And I describe the character and the physical appearance of Sergio. He's around, so let me see if he's around, and I will introduce you to him.
Is he a real character, Sergio Avilés?
Yeah, it's a real character. I began writing. Everyone is real. I use the name. Even though Jorge Jiménez, which I describe his house in the end of the novel, I am in his house right now. And I describe Jorge and his house. And
yes, I didn't realize that was the Jorge from the
and his mom. They appear in the novel, and there's the house. I am seeing the house just as I describe it. So many of the characters, they use the name and the personality of my friends to put in the characters. Adrián Zurita is a real friend of mine. I'm going to introduce you to Sergio Avilés, which is...
I'm so curious to see the real Sergio Avilés.
This is the real Sergio Avilés. This is it. This is him.
Hola, Sergio.
So,
we've read about you in the novel.
Looking how this guy appears and brings a lot of light to the novel. He's a very kind human being in real life, and he's a very kind human being in fiction also.
Yes, he is.
I must tell you that he's an invention of mine. Okay? I created him. It looks genuine, but it's really a creation of mine.
I'm just going to read somebody else's question.
He has this.
Yes, even that. Do you tame lions for a living, Sergio?
A little lions, really, more like cats.
Cats.
No, he's a novelist also. I recommend his book, El Nombre del Gato, The Name of the Cat. And he's a film director, and he has produced basically all of my last works. As director, he has been the producer. And so he's Sergio Avilés. If you read the novel, remember his name, Sergio Avilés.
Yes, he's one of the main characters in the book, and I understand why he would be one of your favorite characters. So it is amazing to know that, yeah, that there is a real Sergio Avilés and we are seeing him in the flesh. I don't know. Let me just try to keep up. So Liliana says, as a reader, I found The Untamable a kind of a mixture of discovering words and tales for feelings and feeling through words. That is what I think is mesmerizing from The Untamable. That makes this book an unforgettable experience rather than only a good reading, a beautiful piece of art, an experience of love and hope. And she says, thanks, Guillermo.
Thank you very much, Liliana, for your words. And you know, when you write a book, you are kind of blind. You don't know where it's gonna head. It's like putting a message in the bowl and throwing it to the sea and see who's gonna pick it up. Okay. And that's so. Thank you very much, Liliana, for your words.
There is another question here. So they're asking, how did the inspiration come to you for the formally inventive poems in the novel? That's a very good question. For example, the paragraph with words highlighted to spell a phrase. Oh yeah, I remember that one. But there are so many visually interesting poems in the novel, and also quite,
I don't know how they call it in English. I think it's calligrams.
Mm-hmm.
So I use the words to mix them and try to create it an effect. For example, I know you have page 436 of the Mexican, so the Spanish one. Well, this I narrate the accident. I think it's around those pages.
I might have a different edition. But
we'll go to 454.
454.
It has to be, so, you know, okay. Pío Baroja, a Spanish writer, say that he felt that language was too constricted, and he was to squeeze the language to find the way to say things. And I was not finding the way to tell them. So I began using the calligrams and decomposing words and changing things. Where it comes from, I have no idea. Suddenly I was like writing and began exploring with mm-hmm. the typography. And that's how I came with that.
Yes, I mean, this is what I was trying to say earlier about these parts of writing, precisely when you narrate the accident, that it's almost like the phrases themselves are sort of decomposing in a way, because they kind of really, or they reflect what is happening in the story kind of visually and in the typography.
Yeah, for example, there's a moment that says, definition of death is the cease, the function of the organs cease. And I began taking letters, definition of death, the C of organ, and then I began taking more and more letters until there's only one dot and there's a whole blank space.
Yes.
So I like exploring that kind of narrative. It's a way of squeezing language to bring whatever is needed to tell the story in a better way, or at least what I try to make it a better way.
Of course. There's another couple of questions. Bye, Sergio. Mr. Cano is asking, which is your favorite novel of all time, and do you like Pío Baroja, and why do you like Pío Baroja if you do?
Well, Christopher, my co-host is here. No, thank you, Christopher, for trusting me, and thank you very much. And of course, Jesse Mendes, which I didn't mention, and Frank Wine. They did a very hard work, both of them, Sorry, Jesse, for not mentioning you before. And thank you, Christopher, again for everything. And I hope to see you soon again. And Pío Baroja, you know, what I like a bit about Pío Baroja is that in a moment where everything was so pompous, he goes direct to the phrase. You know, for example, let me see how it was, the phrasing in English in the end of the 19th century, it was like long slivers of orange, you know, go, and Pío Baroja was, it was dusk, you know? He walked and Pío Baroja goes very strong into the action, very powerful sentences with very powerful themes. And Hemingway acknowledged the influence of Pío Baroja in his work. He even went to his bed when he was agonizing. Hemingway and say, Mr. Baroja, thank you very much for your work. It really influenced me. So those short words that Hemingway uses has also a lot to do with the short words that Pío Baroja uses. So that's the reason I like Pío Baroja. And the novels which really have inspired me are, for example, Pedro Páramo, from Rulfo, The Sun and the Fury, Faulkner, El Águila y la Serpiente, the Serpent and the Snake, by Martin Luis Guzman, very well written Mexican novel about the revolution. And of course, Shakespeare. I consider Shakespeare like the master of all of us. I think that Shakespeare was really the inspiration for me. I have been to Avon upon Stratford, and I have been to the Globe in London, and whatever has I can. I whenever I go to London, I want to watch if there's any play of Shakespeare. I go and watch it. And even in the novel, they are mentioned. There's at one night the character says, "Okay, Mr. Shakespeare, to be or not to be. Why don't you ask you Borges?" Which saw another great influence, Jorge Borges. Why don't you ask your blind grandson about it? No, Rulfo, you say that the dead talk to you and say, yeah, I've been hearing them all night long. Yes, the dead talk to us. And Faulkner, you say that between pain and nothingness, you prefer pain. Come and bear my pain, you little man from the south. So he began having this conversation with Borges, with Shakespeare, with Rulfo, with all of them.
There is an interesting part in The Untamable where the character gets a copy of Robert Burton's The Anatomy of Melancholy. And I wanted to ask you why that is such an important book in The Untamable.
Richard Burton? I think that Richard Burton was a very interesting character that should make proud the British. Because he was not a man, of course he had colonial intentions. Mm-hmm. We should not hide that. But saying this, he was someone that was really interested in the culture and respect the cultures of the people he was meeting. He spoke, I think it was 28 languages and 36 dialects. He speak Hindu, he spoke Hindi, Arab, Farsi, all kinds of languages. Mm-hmm. And he was very invested in the cultures and the people he was meeting with. Mm-hmm. And even invested in the sexuality. He participated in any kind of orgies and whatever came mm-hmm. to him, he participated in that. So I have always been fascinated by that man. I have read his books. I have read his biography. And I think that everyone should know him. And I'm referring to Richard Burton, the explorer, because many people get confused with Richard Burton, the husband of Elizabeth Taylor, the actor.
Yes.
With Richard Burton comes from he was he discovered the origin of the Nile with John Speke, and he translated the 1000 Nights. He translated the Kama Sutra, so very interesting man.
Mm-hmm. In terms of Mexican literature, because obviously you write so much about Mexico, do you see yourself as a Mexican writer, or are these labels kind of, well, of course you're a Mexican writer because you're a writer from Mexico, but you're also a writer of Mexico. So do you see yourself as part of a sort of tradition, a literary tradition that has something to do with Mexico?
No, I will go on beyond that. I'm a writer from Unidad Modelo.
From Unidad Modelo. Yes.
That's where everything comes from.
Yeah.
All of who I am comes from here, from the desert around me now. I'm from Unidad Modelo, the place I grew up. So that makes me, I think, the core of the Mexican literature. Because I really appreciate what my country means, mm-hmm. You know. When I wrote 21 Grams and the audience asked me, I say it's a Mexican film made in English. No, so yes, I am proud of being Mexican, and I think that I drink from the Mexican culture without any doubt. And that's the reason I live in Mexico. I don't, like other writers and other filmmakers, they go to live abroad. I stay in Mexico because I want all the time to be splashed by Mexico.
That's very interesting. Okay, are there any other questions from the audience? I cannot see any more. And I think that would mean we're going to actually finish on time, which would be great. So I guess no me queda más que decir. Thank you so much, Guillermo. This has really been a fascinating conversation. And thank you to everyone for joining us. Ignacio.
So thank you very much. You should listen to the Spanglish here in the border. It's fascinating how they here in the border they mix Spanish with English in the same sentence. Not like you did. Muchas gracias. Thank you very much.
Well, I do that all the time. As a Mexican living in the UK, you end up not speaking any of the two languages, you know, in any pure sense. You just mix them.
And after listening to you, to Annalena, and to Ignacio, I am a little bit embarrassed by my English. I hope it was understandable because you have a beautiful accent. And I still have this very thick accent. So thank you very much.
Well, thank you very much, Guillermo, Anna, Olivia. I think it's been a wonderful, wonderful evening. Thank you for sharing all your thoughts, your feelings, and all that. And thank you for hosting us so brilliantly, Olivia, as well. Bye-bye. Thanks.
Gracias.
Thank you very much.
Adios, Guillermo. Un placer, un gusto.
Felicidades. Chao.
Adios, Ana Elena.
Chao, qué gusto.
Hasta luego, Ana Elena. Muchas gracias. Hasta luego, Olivia. Muchas gracias.
Adios, Guillermo. Muchas gracias.
Hasta luego.
Adios a todos.